So, Paul, you've shown us that if you take the idea behind quantum mechanics, the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, and you combine that with the ideas behind gravity, that you can push things together with gravity, and the Heisenberg uncertainty principle ultimately ends up pushing things apart, you can explain something like these white dwarfs that we see, these really massive stars.
Yeah, we've solved one of the problem of how you can make something that dense not collapse, how it can actually support itself against its intense gravity. But there's still another problem, a nasty one, which is we need this lump to be not made of hydrogen. If it's hydrogen, it's going to nuclear fuse. But most of everything in the universe is hydrogen. What isn't hydrogen is helium, which is almost as bad. How can we get something that isn't hydrogen and helium, a dense lump of the stuff, when that's not what most of the universe is made out of?
Well, I have an idea. If we look at our sun is made out of primarily hydrogen and helium. But of course, it's being powered by the conversion of hydrogen to helium, and then we believe eventually helium to things like carbon and oxygen. So one could imagine that if we looked at a star like our sun, not now, but later on, after it's burned through most of its nuclear fuel, in the center, you should have a reservoir of a bunch of stuff, which is like carbon and oxygen, or maybe helium, depending on exactly how the nuclear processes work. So that's a good place to look.
Okay, so in the middle of a star, you're going to accumulate just what we want, a large, dense pile of heavier elements. But the trouble is, it's only ever going to be the core of the star. In our own sun, it's only about the central half a percent that's actually doing nuclear fusion. Most of the rest is just this incredibly thick blanket of hydrogen, which is just there to press down on that central half a percent to make it dense enough to undergo nuclear fusion. Even when a star like our sun comes to the end of its life, it's still only going to be a little bit in the middle that's turned into this dense stuff. You've still got this huge shell of hydrogen around the outside. How are you going to get rid of that?
Well, I think the best thing to do is to go out and have a look around the universe. When we look out in the universe, we see that all stars are not exactly like our sun. Some of the objects are much, much bigger than our sun, not in terms of mass, but in terms of size. And we call these red giant stars. And indeed, we believe our sun in the future is going to turn into a red giant, because it turns out that the nuclear reactor in the center of our sun changes over time. Right now, it's burning hydrogen into helium. But in the future, that's going to exhaust that supply of hydrogen, and it's going to start wanting to burn the hydrogen in a shell outside of the core into helium. And when it does that, it's going to become much more energetic, and that's going to cause the outer part of the star to puff up to a size much, much bigger than today, almost all the way out to where the Earth is. And so that red giant star, of course, doesn't solve our problem. But that big puffy star, that gas is only barely attached now to the core because the gravity is so much weaker.
Yes, if you look at images of red giants or red supergiants, you see they're actually rather fuzzy edged. It's very hard to get a picture of these things, but what pictures you can get using clever adaptive optics and similar techniques show that in fact it's not like our own sun with a nice sharp edge. It's a very fuzzy edge, and a lot of stuff is actually being blown out of these things.
That's right, because they're not very stable. And as I said, the thing that makes our sun round is the fact that there's just so much gravity. I mean, it's much, the gravity is really pulling things together and making a giant sphere. Here, things get extended, and this is one of the few stars where you can actually see the star and how big it is. And this leads us naturally to a time when, for example, the star itself runs completely out of its ability to fuse its hydrogen and helium into heavier elements. And then what's going to happen? The center of the star is going to be overcome by gravity, and it's going to want to come together till it is reaches that magical point where that quantum mechanical pressure pushes back and stops it. But there's going to be a lot of energy in that process. You have this weakly attached envelope of stuff, and it's likely to get, blown off a little bit into something you might see like this, a planetary nebula. Possibly my favorite object in the cosmos. And you can see right in the center, you've got a white dwarf, a really tiny star that's massive, we've been talking about. And then you got all this junk that has sort of been blown off, not you know, really violently, but kind of gently, to form this amazing neon sign in the sky.
Yes, there's a lot of beautiful pictures of these things. Here are some taken by the Hubble Space Telescope.
That's one of my favourites.
This is lovely, yes. What's lighting this all up is the ultraviolet light from the white dwarf in the middle. This core in the middle is, as you said, very small, very dense, and very hot, because it's just come out of the middle of a star. And so it's so hot it's emitting ultraviolet light, which is coming out and zapping the gas around it, knocking the electrons up the energy levels. As they fall back down again, they emit all these lines we see. So they're absolutely beautiful things, but we're seeing that in fact most of the mass of what was in the middle here, this is a star maybe much like our own sun, and it's lost most of its mass. Most of the mass has been blown out in these cataclysmic last few days, weeks, months, years, leaving just behind the core. So maybe we can, in this method, get rid of all this huge blanket of hydrogen and give us a core.
So, yes, these things litter the sky. But they don't last very long, so it's quite interesting. They're not rare in the sky, and for astronomical objects, these planetary nebula really only have lifetimes of order 100,000 years or so. So they are short-lived, and that tells you that it's not an unusual phenomenon. Almost every star that's born is going to end up producing one of these at some point to explain how many that we see across the sky.
But then after their 100,000 years or so is over, the nebula has faded away, you're still going to be left with a white dwarf. It's not got any power source anymore. It's not actually generating any energy, but it's got a lot of heat inside it because it started off at a very, very high temperature, and it will just slowly cool down as it radiates the heat. So it might start off at a very high temperature. As time goes on, it'll get a little bit cooler, a little bit cooler, a little bit cooler. So it might start off as a very blue-coloured dwarf and then become a bit more white, and eventually might end up sort of yellow or even red as it cools down, though probably the universe isn't old enough for them to reach that stage yet.
Sort of a cooling ember, you know, a rock that you heat up in a fire, and then you know that if you grab that rock very soon afterwards, you're going to burn your hand because it's still hot. And so, but it cools over time, and because things that are hot glow, you can see these things. And they literally litter the sky, these white dwarfs, and it's a beautiful process that makes them.
So, pretty amazing things. This white dwarf, the whole mass of a sun in the size, it's only the size of a planet, the incredible density, the incredible gravity, the combination of quantum mechanics and gravity. They're amazing things, but they're not really all that violent. This is, of course, on the violent universe. Or are they? Well, that's what we're going to talk about next time.